Good evening, this is Tim Johnson, and the Brattleboro Select Board is next here on BCTV. Tonight's agenda includes the following: a liquor license for the owners of 39 Main Street in Brattleboro, which apparently will be reopening as a restaurant after it had closed a couple of years ago. Action to approve a change order for the water and sewer upgrade project. Town Finance Director John Leisenring will have his monthly financial report. Recycling coordinators Moss Kaler and Cindy Sterling are in the audience, and they'll update us on their work for the town of Brattleboro. A discussion of canceling a purchase and sale agreement for town-owned property at number 246 South Main Street. A contract agreement or contract extension for several spaces in the Harmony lot that are owned by Jonathan Chase and Chase LLC. A grant appropriation for the Brattleboro Community Justice Center will be acted upon, as well as a highway safety equipment incentive grant. There'll be an appointment to the Brattleboro Planning Commission. The board is looking for people to volunteer for the Citizen Police Communications Committee. As of yet, no one has. And the board has received two applications for people interested in serving on the Transportation Committee. And last but not least, the year in review, according to Brattleboro Select Board Chair Dick DeGray. All that and more, the Brattleboro Select Board is next here on BCTV.
I'd like to reconvene our February 15th meeting, actually our last regularly scheduled meeting for this select board. I accept a motion on the minutes from January 24th.
So moved.
Any corrections, additions, deletions? Seeing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
5-0. I'd accept a motion on the minutes from February 1.
I'd make that motion to approve those minutes.
Any additions, corrections, deletions? Seeing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
And our regularly scheduled meeting on February 1.
So moved.
Again, additions, corrections, deletions? Seeing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
5-0. Thank you. Chair's remarks. I'd like to pass along our condolences to the Blanche Moise family, a true Brattleboro icon, and she will be missed, but certainly not forgotten. On March 1st, next week, the 22nd, this board will meet again. We did receive two petitions from the town meetings that we had, referendum questions that will go to you, the voters, to decide. Both of these questions were defeated by town meeting members, and they are one question will be to increase the size of the board from 5 to 7, and the second question that you'll be voting on will be to change the terms from 3 and 1 to 3 and 2. And when we warn that meeting, that vote will be taking on March 1, and we're hoping for a high voter turnout. Certainly do your homework before you go and cast your vote there. And again, I think those are two important questions that affect the town in more ways than people think on the surface, so really think long and hard before you cast your vote there. Harris Hill this weekend, and we're going to hear from Liz Richards in a few moments about that. And last but not least, this Saturday, along with Harris Hill, three of my good friends will be stepping down from a program that they have volunteered for. Charlie Siggins, who has been a volunteer for the town and the Brattleboro Youth Basketball Program for 37 years. Saturday will be his last day. Ike Bergeron, who has been with us for, I think, 22 years, he will be stepping down. Steve Clark, who has been with us for 20 years, he will be stepping down. And if you think about it, every Saturday from the first Saturday in December all the way up until usually the first Saturday in March, we have had basketball, and those gentlemen have been integral part of it. Charlie Siggins, we actually named the program after him. So those are some of the people in our community, and we have many of them who are really under the radar that make our community what it is. And I really want to thank them for all the years of coaching those young starlets that go up and play in the high school team. So thank you very much to Charlie, Steve, and Ike. Committee reports. Yes.
The Wastewater Committee had a meeting at the Wastewater Treatment Plant with some officials from Pizza Galley, the state, Steve Barrett's crew, and a few of us from the Oversight Committee. And it was just a basic getting ready for the big dig, or whatever you want to call it, starting, hopefully it's nothing like the big dig, starting in March. So it's going to be a big project for the town. It's one that I think that the Wastewater Oversight Committee has to really stay involved with, because we're talking about a $32 million plus project. And I think it's important that the town really keeps its eye on the ball on this one. Thank you.
I have something not committee related. Just want to request for folks to, even if it's snowing outside, to please clean up after your dog. One of the things that's been exposed over the last couple of days with the melting is the number of piles of poop that are on the sidewalk. And aside from the fact that it's unsightly and people have to step in there, it doesn't reflect well on our community. When you leave it there, it gets washed into the sewers, which basically goes into the river. So if you clean it up, it goes somewhere else, and you can collect it and take it over to the Project Cow at the Windham Solid Waste District. But aside from that, please clean it up. And if you're on the trails, find a stick. Find something and push it away from the center of the trail. I mean, I must have cleaned up about two dozen piles in the last week being on the trails out at Solar Hill. And again, it doesn't reflect well in our community, and lots of people use those spaces, and it's nice that we have those trails for dogs. And I would, I would hate for it to suddenly be closed to dogs because people aren't cleaning up after themselves. So thank you.
I just wanted to say one other thing about the referendum questions, because we have people who have already cast their vote in absentee balloting, that we, the town clerk is aware of that. Those people who have received absentee ballots will be notified that they will be able to vote on the special article question. Other than that, I think I'm all set. Public participation is an opportunity for you to speak about something that is not on our agenda here this evening. We'll give you roughly about 2 minutes, give or take. And when you come up to the microphone, please state your name, the town that you're from, and what you'd like to talk about. And I'm actually going to call on Liz, because Liz Richards with Harris Hill, she has a meeting she has to get to. So, Liz, you're right there.
It's on?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Hi, I'm Liz Richards from Dummerston, Vermont. And thank you to Barbara and the Select Board for inviting me to. I just want to say a few words about Big Weekend, Harris Hill Ski Jumping Weekend. For those of you that haven't seen the newspaper, listened to the radio, seen our signs around town, the event is this Saturday and Sunday, February 19th and 20th. The gate on Cedar Street will open at 10 o'clock, the entrance to the parking lot. a few things. Cedar Street will be one-way traffic only from Western Avenue. There will be no parking on either side of Cedar Street. And when the parking lot at the base of the hill is filled up, there's additional parking at the Brattleboro Retreat, the parking lots in the rear, and we will have shuttle buses bringing people to and from. The shuttle buses will probably start around 9:45 and go till the event is over, maybe 3:30. Our opening ceremony start at 11 o'clock, and this year the national anthem is going to be performed by local renowned jazz soloist Samira Evans. So we're very happy that she agreed to sing the national anthem both days. We have one of our largest field of competitors ever. We have over 40, close to 50 competitors coming, plus four Europeans, two past winners of the Harris Hill event. Each one has a leg on our trophy. Both are named Christian. Christian Reiter from Austria and Christian Lamb from Andover, New Hampshire are returning. Plus Ukrainian Vladimir Glifka, who retired the last Harris winged trophy back in 2000, is returning to Brattleboro also. He's a real crowd pleaser. We have many concessions, both, you know, for-profit, non-profits being represented, a variety of foods, hot and cold beverages, plus the popular beer tent. We have a bonfire. There's huge snowbanks everywhere. It's unbelievable. Advance tickets are currently on sale, $12 for an adult, $10 for children 6 through 12. If you purchase at the gate, it's $15 and $12. Under 6 is free. Advance tickets can be purchased. There are many Main Street venues, Galanis's Vermont Country Store, the Chamber of Commerce, People's United Bank, Savings and Loan, Woody's, Burroughs, and also the Avenue Grocery on Western Avenue. So with that, I'd just like to say a special thanks to Barbara Sondag and the town, the Select Board, Steve Barrett and Public Works, who did an amazing job plowing that parking lot. I think it took them 2 days. Also the police and fire departments, who are just so cooperative in helping us out, and the Brattleboro Outing Club for letting our Nordic Combined kids use the trails at the country club to practice on when they're not ski jumping. And in closing, a huge thank you to all our sponsors and the community people who are volunteering to help us this weekend, because we couldn't continue this great Brattleboro tradition without all the help that we do get. Thank you.
Thank you, Liz.
Thank you.
I have
a question.
Yeah.
Yeah, I do.
Liz?
The t-shirts, sorry, the t-shirts that I saw at Galanis's store, the black t-shirt, are those going to be for sale?
They will be for sale, right.
Okay. They're really nice.
They are nice. They're $20.
Yeah, really cool.
We have cowbells, t-shirts, posters.
You mentioned the parking at the retreat. Are they not doing the parking at Grafton Cheese this year?
Along Route 30, yes. If it's available.
Okay, so the Grafton Cheese and the retreat.
How far
okay.
You want to walk, exactly. Uh-huh.
Thank you.
Questions?
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Thanks, Liz.
Thank you.
We have our wrap-up meeting tonight.
There you go. Good luck. Actually, last year's winner stayed at my house, so it must have been my cooking that propelled him to victory. And one of the other reasons is the Junior Olympics are next weekend down in Salisbury, so a lot of the participants that are in the Junior Olympics are here. And one of the things that Liz talked about, the Brattleboro Outing Club, because they do Nordic combine, and that is ski jumping and cross-country racing. They're going to have a race Saturday afternoon after the jump up on the Fair Mallory property. So, anyone else with public participation? We need some help with that.
Jeez, I'm
cool. Hi, my name is Elizabeth. I'm also from Brattleboro.
And my question to the select board is about handicap difficulty getting around in town. Those new lights you put up with buttons is great, but they're not shoveled, some of them, to for people in power chairs to get to them, to push them. Some of them have snow in front of them, and some of the ramps still have snow or ice on them, or I can't find them, and I'm still in the road, especially in High Street, crossing High Street from Pliny Park to the other side. I can't find the ramp. There's no ramp there. I see people's footsteps, but I can't go where the footsteps go. So it's not clear there. It's difficult, not just for me, but either people with walkers, canes. It's hard to get around in town. So we're in the street. So we're still in the street. And sidewalks, even after the snow melts, we've got big cracks and big bumps in them that still need to be filled. That I've seen, like in front of the Key Bank, they've replaced those nice big blocks, but about a couple feet away, there's a big crack I thought he was going to fill. And I asked him, is he going to do that? And he says, that's not in my job to do that. So if somebody could go around and check all these big cracks in these sidewalks to take care of it, then we would be back on the sidewalk without the bumps. It's just hard for us to get around. And if you see us in the street, that's why we're in the street. Okay? And that's it for me. Did you want to say anything?
My name is Gary Snyder, and I'm from Brattleboro. I'm a member of the ADA and VCIL, as well as the advisory board to Brattleboro Select Board. I have been out and about a little bit this week, and I've noticed that things that were supposed to have been done as far as working on the sidewalks and stuff have not. They assured me that it was going to be done, and it wasn't done. And I'd like to know who's responsible for the road down to the railroad tracks by the railroad station. Is the town responsible for that, or?
The road, or the sidewalk?
The what? The road.
The road is, it's a town, well, I mean, it's a state road because it's Route 119, but it's an agreement between the town and the and the state on depending on what work is that has to be done.
Well, just before you get to the railroad tracks, there's huge holes, very deep holes, right there as you get to the railroad tracks, and it's going to take out somebody's front end on their car, anybody in a wheelchair who can't use the sidewalk because it wasn't fixed like it was supposed to have been fixed. It's still icy. You can't put a power chair on there because you'll slide right off into traffic. Therefore, we have to go down the side of the road with traffic oncoming, making it dangerous for us and also the people driving the cars. Another thing, the stores right across from the Latches Theater have what appears to be an old painted over mailbox on the in front of the building, which is compounded by the fact that there's snow built up right there next to a sign. I had trouble getting through there. I got thrown into the sign a couple of times trying to get through there. That should have been taken care of. And we're still having trouble with some of the sidewalks not being cleaned off by the merchants. There's a lot of ice on them some places and snow. Um, I was assured by Steve Barrett that that sidewalk that runs down the by the railroad station was going to be filled in, redone over, so we could use that sidewalk to go to Walmart or wherever. That's it for me.
Can I respond to some of those issues? Some of the sidewalk work hasn't been done yet. There was limited sidewalk work that was done with this, with the paving project. And so the KeyBank, the sidewalk in front of, like the sidewalk in front of KeyBank, that was actually a KeyBank project. And so there is a part that, that didn't get done. The hope is that in this upcoming year, there will be, we do have money for additional sidewalk work. And the hope is that that will happen during the upcoming construction season. But there is not enough money to do redo all the sidewalks, so, you know, set the expectations at a realistic level. The road going down to, I think part of the issue, I will check with the Department of Public Works on making sure where we are shoveling and we are taking care of the sidewalks, that those push buttons are available to people. Some of those were missed because they were new and they weren't on somebody's kind of list to do. I thought we had taken that, I thought we had taken care of that now, but we obviously haven't. So we have department meeting tomorrow and we'll talk about that. The road 119 going over to Walmart, part of that didn't get paved because you need a right of entry permit from the railroad, and due to the many, many difficulties that the state had with getting the right of entry permit, they actually didn't get it for that, and that's why that didn't get paved. And unless there's some other type of right of entry permit that's gotten, that space will continue to be that section of road. I think it's like, you know, 20 feet on either side of the railroad tracks is going to continue to be of issue. We have talked with V-Trans, is aware of the issue. The Federal Transit Authority is aware of this problem. It's an issue. And at this point, I'm not sure how that will get, how we'll be able to get that resolved. Some of the sidewalks we're having trouble with because of the snow melt coming down onto the sidewalk and then freezing. I was downtown walking this today too. There are many areas that would be very difficult for anybody, any you know, fully able-bodied person to walk, much less. I almost went down a couple times. Those are And I'm not sure, to be honest with you, I'm not sure how we can solve some of those problems, how well we can do it, because when you have the snow coming off the, and you have the warming sun and the warming temperatures and then the freezing nights, it's going to continue to be a problem. And the more we work, the more things we put on the sidewalk, the worse condition the sidewalks are going to get into as well. I will talk about it at department head meeting where we can talk about that. I know that area coming from Pliny Park over, part of that, we can talk with some of the merchants right there who do some of that shoveling. Those are real issues, and those are solvable things. So we need to get, there are definitely things that you're bringing up that are solvable and that should be solved and shouldn't be, and should be just be on an ongoing basis solved.
Yes.
Can you contact the select board over in Hinsdale? I've had quite a few people ask me why the walkways going over to Walmart haven't been touched, as far as, you know, shoveling them off and plowing and whatnot. I realize they can't put a machine on there, but they can take a snowblower and blow them, you know, snowblow them off. so that...
I don't know if they do. I don't know if Hinsdale, if the town of Hinsdale does any sidewalk plowing. I don't know. We can ask, but I don't know if they do any.
Yeah, well, see, I've been told that, you know, the state's responsible, and then I've been told the town of Hinsdale's responsible.
Across that bridge.
You know, and they're just playing ring around the rosy. And it's going to create big problems. It really is, because somebody's going to get hit going across that bridge in a wheelchair, both bridges. And God forbid if it's me.
Yeah, you.
The other suggestion to that, somebody thought it was a good idea if you talk to the Hinsdale probation and parole people that have to do community time. They could do their community time by shoveling off the bridges and the trail to clear it for Walmart, for people who need to clear it. But the other suggestion is, who's going to be responsible? Is it Hinsdale or Brattleboro that we need a railing up between the two bridges, because there's no railing on the side of the river, where sometimes some of that sidewalks tilts, and people with power chairs are afraid if they make one move, they're going to go over the edge into the river. We'd like to see a railing up, and I don't know if it's our problem or their problem or both.
Where are you talking about?
Between the bridges.
That's
New Hampshire. It's not Hinsdale, that'd be the state.
It's the state.
That would be their state. State of New Hampshire.
Is there any way, do I need to take care of it, or can you talk to them? Do you need me to do it?
I would. I can try and talk to somebody, but I cannot. I can tell you that I'll be surprised if anything happens.
It would be happening, though, if somebody did go over, wouldn't it? If somebody did go over into the river with a power chair. My mother is in a power chair, and she's paranoid of edges. And so she will not take that road. She'll go on the road, and she won't take that path, because she's afraid to fall into the river. So I just make that point.
Dora?
From a reality standpoint, as far as the New Hampshire thing, you know, my suggestion would be that you find whatever the advocacy group is that works with ADA issues on the other side of the river,
okay,
to help out with from the state perspective.
Okay.
You know, I mean, that's what you really need, and you might also find some people in the community that are like yourselves that could go to the local legislator over there, and you know, just as you could work with the legislators here too on the state road issues as well.
Okay.
You know, I mean, the reality is that our road crews and the Public Works Department are extremely overstressed at the moment, and they're doing the best that they can. And you know, I have noticed the same things that you've noticed. You know, I do want to ask, if we can make sure that people are taking notes, because there are, you know, one of the issues with some of the crossings is now there are drainage issues in places where there didn't used to be drainage issues. So in the places where they've put the new crosswalks and it's flatter, the water is now not draining. Now part of the reason is because there are blocks of ice there, but it's also, even in places where there aren't blocks of ice, there are huge, huge puddles that if somebody was trying to go through with a chair,
yes,
or somebody with a cane, or you know, that would be really difficult for them.
Yes,
those
right.
are Thank some you. Of those issues are ice within the storm water system. As you may see ice at the top, those that water is going down, there's also ice that forms in there. You can put some chemicals down there to help dissolve the ice, but you do run some risks, because mm-hmm. then you have further problems down at the wastewater treatment plant. So nothing, there's not a silver bullet for some of these
no.
issues.
I just you know, wanted to mention that, because I, you know,
Bill?
I'm glad you did. Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm Bill Knowles. I'm from Brattleboro. I'm so glad we're talking about this. There's 12 chairs in this town. 12 people in chairs in this town. That's a lot of chairs to be getting around town. You don't see them in the last 3 months because they can't go anywhere. The sidewalks are pretty damn good, actually, but the corners are impossible to pass. The corner down by the co-op has 13 by 6 by 3 foot pile of snow right on the ramp. And during the day, it melts and it goes, spreads itself out. So the whole ramp is ice, solid ice. These people here, I know, can't get their chairs around that snowbank. Maybe they can, but I don't think so. And then they hit the ice that's down there, and that's another drainage problem. But I'm glad we're communicating, because I sit there, I'm on the Main Street all the time, and the dragonfly, that's horrible, absolutely horrible, that they're not taking responsibility for their sidewalk.
Well, let me just, the property owners, and let's be clear, because you can go and name a store.
Okay.
But the truth of the matter is, every property owner in the downtown is responsible for the sidewalk. Now, whatever is in their lease is another issue, but it is the property owner, so we don't want to disparage a property owner that might be a renter there. That's the owner of the property is ultimately responsible for cleaning the sidewalk. So I just want to make that clear.
And I understand that, but I don't come up here with a
I understand that.
Okay, so I'm just throwing names out. Maybe
the
they'll
corner
be,
of High
maybe they'll
Main
be
Street.
Upset. Maybe they'll be upset with me, and maybe they'll take care of their walk. Whoever is responsible for that corner,
that's right,
and the corner down by the co-op, should pay attention, because they're not getting done.
Okay.
There's 3 inches of ice on the ramp in front of that building that I was just talking about.
Yes.
3 inches of ice, solid ice. I saw a woman fall at the winter market. I was across the street, saw a woman fall, and I went and got salt from the river garden and brought her back and salted in front of that button, because there was 3 inches of solid ice that people were walking over to go across the street to the winter market. You know, somebody's got to pay attention. I'm glad we're talking about it, and the answers, the questions that are being asked, I hope there will be answers for those questions. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else? Yes.
Possibly difficult transition. My name is Ken Schneck. I live in West Brattleboro. I'm also the Dean of Students at Marlboro College. And just wanted to let people know about a new initiative that we are undertaking. We're calling it a First Friday drop-in down at our grad center. And it's aimed at bringing together LGBT youth and allies, lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender youth in the community who just want to come and either watch a movie or meet other youth or just be around other folks and talk about either issues in the community or just be social. And we very much want this to be a campus community partnership. And so if there are adults, even though I hesitate to use that word, but if there are adults who are either LGBT or allies or just interested in being part of this project, we are definitely looking for chaperones. And you can email me at kschneck@marlboro.edu. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else? Darryl.
I just want to make one little, I was talking to a friend of mine who serves now down in the southern end of our great country here, and we were talking, and he says, you know, one of the things that I really notice is down here, the reason why we have more money to spend, he says, is because of winners. He sat up here on the select board here, and our budget gets hit pretty hard, and because of how hard we have to work at keeping the taxes low, because that is the one thing we really hear a lot about, these are the things that happen. We are listening. We try like crazy to do the best we can. We don't want you to have to come here and say that, really. We'd like it to be easier for you to move. But we're also under some wicked constraints in this small town. And I just wanted to bring that up, because we talked for a while about it, and it was amazing how much leftover cash that gives them down there to spend on other things. So,
Dora?
Well, I just wanted to add to that. You know, there are things that the town can do and the town can do well from the town government perspective. And then there are other things that just need community. And if everyone takes a little time to chop up some ice, kick away some snow, as they're walking down the street and you're walking in your boots, it would make it so much easier for those that are disabled that have difficulty walking through. You know, clearing puddles and making channels for the water to drain. All of those are things that if you took a few minutes, or making sure that the gutter that's next to your driveway is open, these are all things that, one, would make it easier for everybody to get around, and but also, if the water's not sitting, and much of that is full of salt and other things, then it's not causing as much damage to the sidewalks and the road, which ultimately, as Daryl mentioned, costs us more money.
Jesse, yes. Do you have anything, Jesse?
Yeah, I do. And not about that stuff. This is my last meeting.
Jesse, why don't you hold it?
Okay.
He's got a 4-page speech.
Yeah.
He's
got 10-page.
Yeah. We're going to wait till we adjourn, Jess. Then you can give it.
When no one's watching.
Why don't you turn the lights out when you leave?
Okay. Don't let the door hit in the back, right?
Any other? Actually, the first time we've had a unison laugh in a long time. Thank you. Thank you for raising those concerns. As Daryl said, they don't go unheard. It's been a very difficult winter. It's been several years since we've had one with this much snow, and some things we need to get a little bit better at, and thank you for bringing them to our attention. Seeing no other people for public participation, I'd accept a motion to go into liquor commissioners.
So moved.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
5-0. And we are up.
Thirty-nine Main. Luna Azul Inc. is requesting a first-class liquor license at 39 Main, and that will also be the name of the
Restaurant.
Actually, we'll be doing business as Luna Azul.
Right.
Well, listen, I'll make it a motion.
Yeah, I had that wrong. It will be Luna Azul, doing business as Luna Azul.
Inc., right?
Do you want to come up and sit down? Oh. You don't have to, but you can.
Oh, I'm sorry. Well, you're good.
Well, I saw the minutes.
I apologize. I was on the wrong...
wrong line.
I was on the wrong line. Yeah, sorry about
doing
that.
Doing business as 39.
And I make a motion to approve the first-class liquor license for Luna Azul, how do you say it?
Luna Azul.
Azul, Inc., DBA 39 Main Street, located at 39 Main Street.
Well, it'll be DBA Luna Azul.
That's
right. I don't know if that has to be read into the minutes.
All right. Yeah. We're going to get rid of that. Jan, you know what you're doing because you do an excellent job. Located at 39 Main Street with a condition that the owner contact Assistant Fire Chief Lynch for a safety inspection of the restaurant prior to opening.
Which we had, and I have here.
There you go.
Oh, you're in business.
Yes, and the chief Bukowski said that you're very hospitable.
Oh, well, that's nice.
You want to talk a little bit about your
restaurant?
Well, it's going to be upscale Mexican, and I'm hoping that by having the liquor license, we'll also have some fine wines to go with food, and that way we can attract not just people that want to come in and get a burrito, which is great, because I'd love them to come too, but also people that want to come from out of town, tourists, spend a little bit more money, which allows me to hire more people, which of course gives more taxes to Brattleboro. Yeah. So.
Gives you more of a headache, though.
It does give me more of a headache, but I'm never going to see my husband again after the restaurant opens anyway, unless he comes to visit me. So.
And when are you opening?
We were hoping to open a week from Wednesday.
Very good.
Thank you.
Well, good luck.
Thank you.
Yeah.
All those in favor of any further discussion?
Wonderful. Come down.
All those in favor of the motion on the floor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? 5-0.
Excellent.
There you go.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And I know you got tacos. I'm kind of boring.
There'll be several on the menu.
Okay.
I move to get out of liquor commissioners.
We're terrible.
Oh, we gotta go. I gotta go eat.
Accept a motion to adjourn as liquor commissioners.
So moved.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
5-0. I'll accept a motion to go into water and sewer commissioners.
So
So moved.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Okay.
Only order of business up is there was one change order with the RBCs, and that was to our favor, $2,500. And that's coming before the board, seeking the approval with the understanding that when the new board is seated, we will be having a special meeting where we discuss the wastewater treatment plant project, and we discuss in more depth how we will handle future change orders.
Okay.
I move to approve the RBC change order in the amount of $2,500.
Discussion?
That is in our
$2,500 in our favor.
That's right.
It's got to be a first.
Yeah.
There you go.
I was looking for a plus there or something.
Further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? 5-0. And why not? Accept the motion to adjourn as Water and Sewer Commissioners. Mm-hmm. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed? 5-0.
New
business.
You have the monthly reports for the period ending July 31st. In addition to the normal regular reports, you have two other reports. One is a kind of a sources and uses of the wastewater treatment plant upgrade, and the other is the Tri-Park sources and uses, kind of a summary of them.
John?
Barb just gave it to me.
That's it?
Actually, the financial reports for the month of January were at 58.3% of the fiscal year. The general fund expenditures are at 53.76%, the utilities at 51.72%, and the parking fund at 54.47%. I don't have any other particular comments. If you have any questions. As Barb mentioned, I've also provided in a kind of an account reconciliation for the Tri-Park project. I've prepared a spreadsheet that shows all of the payments to each of the vendors, including Willie Excavating, Zaluzny Construction, and the SDE Engineers. And I've also allocated or have a column for each of the two loans that were involved in that project. And then I did an application summary and a reconciliation. And it's as we have closed out the project, we've expended all but no more than the $2.6 million for the sewer loan and the $3.2 million for the water loan. And we have a couple reconciling items down at the bottom. We owe Tri-Park some money, they owe us some money, and it all works out. It all bounced up. I did a similar reconciliation, at this point, a summary of all the checks we've written to Hoyle Tanner and Infrastructure Inc., and also provided columns for each of the loans that the costs were assigned to. Where we are as of last week. So the Tri-Park, except for the final reimbursement from the bond bank for the water loan, I'm sorry, the sewer loan, we're done. I think we have some more agreements to go with Tri-Park. I've also reported they have made the first deposit towards the debt service reserve. We've opened up an account, an interest-bearing account, in accordance with the development agreement. So everything is on track for that project.
Very good, John. Questions?
No, but I think in terms of the upgrade funding for the wastewater treatment plant, and having this is something probably on a monthly or at least quarterly basis ought to be brought before the board. It seems to me that, as Daryl mentioned earlier, keeping on top and keeping our eye on the ball.
Well, I have been keeping this up on a regular basis. The Tri-Park, I had to go back and reconstruct because I hadn't started that because there was a couple loans involved, and but it got to be more complicated when they started reallocating costs, so I went back and did this one. So it's very easy to maintain once you get it started. So I'll have that. I can provide it monthly or quarterly.
Any other questions on any of the budgets that you have in hand? Seeing none?
I have one just because I was wondering why.
On what page are you?
This is page 14. Of 18 at the top, Public Works, 14 of 18 at the top. I'm just wondering where we are on the gasoline, because it's only saying we're at 11.9%, and I was just wondering why that was, or if it just.
They use mostly diesel, so they only gasoline is smaller pieces of equipment.
Uh-huh. Just because we're sort of more than halfway through the year, and I was just curious as to why that was,
I don't know.
It struck me as interesting. I'm sure there's a reason for it, so.
John, I did notice in the in Daryl's signing of the warrants, when I was going through them, snow removal, which doesn't look like they were posted with this report, is, are we going to be in danger of going over the line item for snow removal, which is at $70,000?
That's
for
probably
the parking?
A question better asked of Steve, but I let me see where we are here.
It's parking.
The parking fund for the
snow
removal?
Oh, parking. I'm sorry.
There's always
a little lag there, so I didn't know if they were.
Again, this is as of the end of January, so some of those bills for January probably haven't been received yet. They will be reflected in the next report.
I think it's safe to
say
that
55%. What's that?
If it doesn't snow, we're good.
It's safe to say that we probably are, we're going to be tight this year with that. The year we had we actually spent closer to 70 or 80,000.
We had $36,000 for the lineup.
Yeah, but that was also it was different types of storms. We had ice and things. We also had hiring contractors for doing the sidewalk in front of the transportation, because we didn't have a maintenance person there. So we should have to see some savings. So, but I would guess that we're going to be close.
Okay. All right. Thank you, John.
For no other reason, just because we've had to haul more snow.
Recycling coordinators, Moss and Cindy.
Anything with props? Sorry.
We can never show up without props.
Props or food are always good.
I know the last time you did this, Cindy, recycling went up 2%.
If you guys are going to stand there, it'd probably be a good idea to take the mic that's there for the audience so you can be heard.
They're going to sit there, right?
Okay, I don't think we can.
Okay,
we can sit if this is a mic.
You want to start?
No.
Okay.
I mean, it's fine if you want to get up. I was just, because there's been sound issues lately, so I just want to make sure you're going to be heard.
Okay. Well, Moss and I were hired in December for just 1 year. So we're almost done with our first quarter. And the tasks that we were hired to take care of would be, one, increase the recycling rate. Two, figure out really how that recycling rate is figured and make sure that we're pulling in all the numbers possible to come up with that recycling rate. We have been busy in order to do that with surveying people, finding out how to tell people best what's recyclable, what's not recyclable, and how to prepare your recyclables. So in our first quarter, we have done a survey of the drop-off sites, which Moss is handing out the results of that. The drop-off sites are in at the high school and on Old Ferry Road at the Wyndham Solid Waste Facility. And I guess now that Moss is sitting here and has passed out the information, it would be a good time maybe to give a summary of those drop-off site survey.
Yep. We did a survey of the drop-off sites, Old Ferry Road and Fairground Road, towards the end of December and ending on New Year's Day. And we had a lot of help from the Solid Waste Committee and other individuals from the community that helped man those survey sites on those days. And we surveyed from 8 in the morning until about 5 at night. It was getting dark then, and thankfully it's light still at 5 o'clock right now. We asked each person who came to the drop-off sites whether they were a Brattleboro resident or not. If they were a Brattleboro resident, we asked them why they were using the drop-off site in lieu of the town-provided service of curbside pickup. And then we also handed them out, if they wanted to take it, we encouraged them to take it, a four-page survey that we asked them to fill out. And we'll talk a little bit more about that in a second. What we found, to make it shorter and sweeter, was that 75% of the users at Fairground Road over by the high school were Brattleboro residents, and 28% of the people who used the drop-offs on Old Ferry Road were Brattleboro residents. And the primary reason, there was a host of reasons, but the predominant reason is, as the people use those sites, was largely, in a word, could be convenience. It was more convenient for these people to use the drop-off sites than to use the curbside program. They either lived at that end of town or they had problems storing recyclables for 2 weeks, so when the recyclables would build up within their household, they would just take them to the drop-off site and they wouldn't be tied down to every other specific day, every other week. Some people said they were confused on which day their curbside pickup was. But it largely came down to convenience for most of them. And when we factored in, and the primary reason we want to do this, as I think Cindy mentioned, was to find out, to get a better handle on what Brattleboro's recycling rate was, to factor in the tonnages of recyclables that were brought to those drop-off sites. Because Fairground Road, during those hours that we watched it, about 10 people per hour came by. And so about 7.5 people per hour from Brattleboro all through the day, every day, come to Fairground Road. So it's a significant tonnage of recyclables. And what it does is, one of the sheets I handed out lists the last 6 months of last calendar year, from July 2010 through December 2010. And the recycling rate that the town has been using to date has just been the tonnages put at curbside, picked up by Triple T. And that rate for those 6 months was 18.8%. And when we factor in the Fairground Road and Old Ferry Road, the rate is a more realistic rate. It's 23.2%. So it goes up about 4.5%. So it's not something phenomenal, right, but it is significant. And so when we, when Cindy and I and the Solid Waste Committee in the future talk about Brattleboro's recycling rate, and we do expect to see it go up as Cindy and I carry on with the coming year and with the help of the Solid Waste Committee, we will be factoring in the tonnages at those two drop-off sites.
And with that in mind, when we started, again, it's a year program that we're contracted for. So we started in December and we will end at the end of November. So in that time, we are really hustling to focus on the residential recycling. And I think our goal at first was 30%, but factoring that we're at 23%, we may decide, and we'll talk to the Solid Waste Committee about this too, but you know, maybe we can up it just a little bit. So by the end of our time in November, maybe it could be a 35 or 40%. And again, you have to consider, what are we factoring into that recycling rate? And we are looking at just the bottles and cans and paper. Now, it could go up if we wanted to start putting in Project Cow, you know, which is our composting at Wyndham Solid Waste, that dumpster that we have there. It could go up if we start taking in textiles. But our consensus is, for now, and it can change as the time goes on, but we were really focusing on the curbside program and the drop-off program, and not really all the extra stuff. Okay, so, you know, if the town wants to look at that differently, again, we can discuss that in the future, but that's where we're going with our numbers for now. The next step of it, doing that survey, and as Moss mentioned, we had handed out, it was sort of our pilot survey. We have an online survey right now. If you go to brattleboro.org, there are 17 questions. It's very brief, 18 if you want to give us an additional comment, about people's recycling habit. The very first question is, are you a Brattleboro resident? If you're not a Brattleboro resident, you don't go any further than this. And we handed it out at the drop-off site. I think about 30 were returned.
About 40.
40. Yeah. It was pretty much just a pilot at that time because we were getting the tweaks out of it. So we were tweaking it. So now we have it. So it is, you know, it's been changed online. It's been improved based on the comments that we got from those 30 people that took it away. And we will be sending out a mailing to every single Brattleboro resident. Now, we do understand that when we do that, sometimes Dummerston, Halifax, Marlborough residents get some of the mailing based on the zip code. So if you are of one of those towns, again, first question is, are you a Brattleboro resident? You don't have to answer it. For the angle of the Wyndham Solid Waste District, if you decide to answer it and you're not a Brattleboro resident, it can only help us determine recycling. We'll still look at the information. So the letter, the packet will be going out by next week. And so it has a letter, it has a survey as well. So if you didn't want to go online, there is the survey that is within the packet, very similar to the one that's online. Same questions. We are also putting in some education material because we felt that the survey was twofold. It helps us see how people are viewing recycling and how they understand recycling in the town of Brattleboro, but it's also an opportunity for us to get that information out about what's recyclable and what's not recyclable. So the flyers that are included in the survey is our traditional what's okay, what's not okay recycling. We also are doing a new flyer that would be on the opposite side that speaks to how to prepare your recyclables. So, I mean, we have three pictures here because I just expanded them, but these three pictures we put on one piece of paper, 8.5 by 11, to tell you how to prepare the recyclables. Because, again, as Moss has been out riding the recycling truck as well as the garbage truck, he's noticed a lot of people's recycling habits. And we really want to get clear how it is to produce your recyclables to us to be able to sort them. And that's why we have here all of these containers, because all of these containers you can put your recyclables in.
Yeah, many people will say, I can't store all my recyclables in the town, which is right down here, the town 18-gallon container. It's not big enough. And the fact of the matter is, almost any one of these containers works fine. I use 2 30-gallon garbage cans at my house. We're a family of three, and they're pretty close to full each time with the co-mingled. One can has the plastics, the bottles and cans and that sort of thing, and the other one has all the paper, box board, junk mail, newspapers, and so on and so forth. That's very good. If you do use a garbage can, be sure you label it in some way, and if you that it's recyclable, so it's clear to the driver, this has recyclables in it, not trash.
and we hope to be having stickers that we can supply to residents that say recycling or recyclables.
That'll
make
it
clear. You can put it on a can. Yep. But a box will work. If you do use a cardboard box, keep in mind that unless you label that box, I want to keep this box, do not take the box, they'll probably dump the recyclables out of that cardboard box and take the box as well, because the cardboard box is recyclable. But any other plastic type of container works fine. A paper bag works fine. What we do not want people to use...
What do you not see on this row as a particular container? What material?
Plastic bags. Plastic bags.
And that's where this picture comes in. No, do not put recyclables in plastic bags.
Or a treat.
And the reason for that is the plastic bag itself is not recyclable. If Andre, who picks up the recyclables for Triple T, throws this entire bag with proper containers in it, but if he throws the entire bag with the plastic bag and it goes to the MRF, that plastic bag can get caught in the conveyor belts and in the rollers, and they can have to shut down the system. It's more work for them. They have to sort it. The other thing Andre sometimes does is he'll rip open the bag, and then he has to dump the stuff out of the bag into his recycling truck. And then, if the trash truck happens to have come before him, he's sitting there with a plastic bag that he's got to put back in the bin. And it makes it really, really, and I've seen him do it many times, it really slows him down a lot. And so plastic bags, starting April 1st, as long as a couple other things I'm going to mention, starting April 1st, any recyclables put at curbside and in a plastic bag will not be picked up. Andre's going to put a sticker on them, and he's going to leave them there. And as well, if you commingle, if you mix all your papers, junk mail, cardboard, along with your containers, plastic containers, glass and cans, if they're all jumbled together, he's not going to pick it up. He's going to put a sticker on your container and leave it there.
And again, this is part of one of the photos that is a part of the flyer that's in the mailing that's going to go to all of the residents.
And
so
if you put recyclables into your trash, that will not be picked up. And there's a lot of that. I've seen it, and it's a little tougher to tell because most people use a black plastic bag. But clearly when you pick something up and it's clanging and clinking and the cans and glass are in there, that's going to be easy for the Triple T driver to put a sticker on it and leave it at curbside. And that's going to be a big hassle for people who happen to have their put recyclables in with their trash and have it left behind, because they're going to have to go open up that bag and sort through it and take the recyclables out. They'll miss that week, so they'll have to hang on to their trash for another week. They're going to have to wait until the next curbside pickup or go to one of the drop-off centers with the recyclables. So we're really hoping that by April 1st, everybody in town knows this is the day from henceforth, if I don't recycle, my trash is not going to be picked up, and it's going to be a terrific headache for the resident to have that bag left behind.
Right.
Sandy, then, could you give us the address? You mentioned the online
yes.
a couple of times, but could you give
yes,
us
yes, online, it's brattleboro.org, so it's the town site, and right on the homepage is Recycle Survey, so you could click right there and take it, or you could go to the trash and recycling menu, which is on the left, go to that page, and again, it's right there as a link. So that's brattleboro.org. You can't miss it. Yeah.
Earlier we were talking in a public participation, talking about what difficulty it is with all the snow and ice we've had this winter for people for pedestrians to get around town. Keep in mind, it also is difficult for Triple T with their recycling and trash pickup. It's difficult for your mailman. It's difficult for your oil man and your propane gas if you have that delivered. All those things. So let's all keep in mind that these people really, really, really work hard, and their job is a lot tougher in the winter than it is in the summer. And we can make it easier for them by being thoughtful and thinking about them.
That has been our major work that we've been doing for this quarter, and we will be moving on into the whole enforcement media campaign, We spoke with BCTV about putting on some PSAs there. As the year goes on, again, we're just going to really be focusing on helping the residential rate increase. We do have an idea to do more business recycling survey as well, you know, a little bit later on into the year, because there has been a request to figure out what downtown can do. Now, the Solid Waste Committee has bins. Do Nancy or Jane want to talk about the downtown bins? And that is something when Moss and I came on, you know, the Solid Waste Committee had some things already going on that they were doing. And so we've been sort of splitting up the work and the downtown bins. I don't know if anyone's ever reported on them. The Main Street bins.
Thank you very much. I love them.
Yeah, Nancy will speak to that one. Thanks.
The new, well, they are new, they're about 5 months old now, I guess. They are a trash recycling combination container, and one of them is located at Pliny Park, and the other is located at the Transportation Center. We've been monitoring those since they were installed, and we find that compliance is not so wonderful. There's lots of commingling. And commingling means you're mixing your stuff in, as Moss was saying, if you commingle your trash and recyclables, that means you put everything in together, including boxboard, cardboard, plastic, glass, and aluminum cans, aluminum or steel cans. So we're finding some contamination in those containers, but they're rather handsome. Containers. They have a rain shield, and there's actually a sample out here in the corridor that you can look at. It says City of Milwaukee on it, but then it's only a sample. But the jobs of the committee itself will be to continue to look for additional recycling containers for the town that could be installed next to the existing containers that take trash, or rather that take everything. There are several sources that we can go to to look for these, but we plan to continue that search.
Great.
Is that enough?
Yeah, that's perfect. Thank you. I just asked Nancy to speak to that, because that was their project that they're heading. A project that Moss and I will be looking into for downtown would be to do the composting container downtown somewhere, as well as another recycling drop-off site in West Brattleboro. We would love to investigate and get something up and running for that as well. Yeah.
Talk
so
to Farm Malari on a compost area. Farm Malari.
Farm Malari?
Talk to Joe.
Okay. Yeah, and so when I say, the compost container, if you go to Old Ferry Road, we have a dumpster that's dressed up like a cow, stickered like a cow, and we would like to be able to put a dumpster somewhere downtown for businesses to be able to use. We just need to find a site for that.
One thing I'd like to mention, this compost dumpster we're speaking of is Project COW, stands for, correct me if I'm wrong, Compostable Organic Waste. And what's really, really neat about it is organic waste in our household is a very extremely significant. About 33% to 50% of the weight of our trash is food and food waste. And that can all go into the Project COW bin. But a lot of other stuff can go in the Project COW bin, too. And that is called the low-grade paper. Paper plates, paper cups, tissues, paper towels, the egg cartons, paper egg cartons that do not go in curbside recycling. The MRF does not handle that, but they can go into Project COW. And all that stuff gets taken to a center or a farm.
A composting facility.
A composting facility, and it all gets shredded. And that's why that lower grade paper can be composted. It gets basically torn into little bits, gets mixed up with all the food, waste, and then the organisms have a field day on all that stuff and turn it into wonderful compost.
Wax. Yep, and wax cardboard is part of that. And that would be our last flyer that's actually in the mailing as well, which I hadn't mentioned. So people in town will know what they can put into the Project COW. And at some point, Triple T is talking about wanting to do curbside composting pickup, which is another thing that Moss and I will be working with them on, a pilot of a neighborhood to see that. And so this flyer, the COW, Project COW flyer, would be all of that material. So our recycling rate in Brattleboro, I think, you know, a 35% would, no problem. We may want to go higher.
There you go.
Are there any questions?
Questions from the board. And actually, let me just start. Moss, you talked about in April that we won't be taking trash bags that have recyclables in them.
Mm-hmm.
Are you going to have a notice in the mailing informing people that that
yes.
is going to happen?
Yes. It is in there.
Yes. It's our cover letter. Fine. Yep.
Okay.
It's mentioned a couple places in there.
Okay. Other questions by the board? And thank you very much for the presentation. And,
actually, another part of the survey, the last question, so it's twice that people will be able to see this if they miss it in the letter, is the town of Brattleboro will start enforcing the mandatory recycling ordinance on April 1st. Recyclables not properly separated or contaminated with non-recyclable items will not be picked up. Recyclables that are at the curb in plastic bags will not be picked up. Trash containing recyclables will not be picked up. And then we ask, will you be able to comply with the recycling ordinance? So they can say yes or no, and if not, why? So.
I appreciate your work on this because I think it's important that we have that adjusted recycling rate, because if that's recycling at the Ferry Road
exactly.
and the Fairground Road. But I would hope for us older you-know-whats that you'll keep that CS recycling rate, because that's what I've grown up with for the last 3 years.
We could do both, yeah.
Yeah, that you keep that at 18.8, because
that's
the one we kept seeing for the last 3 years that I've been on the board. I think it's important to have that adjusted one, because I think that's the true recycling rate.
Mm-hmm.
But I hope that that doesn't get lost in the shuffle.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe at some point we can get rid of it, but for the near future,
okay.
I'd like to see that, what it is, you know,
perfect.
Based on curbside.
Okay.
One second.
I don't actually have. Go ahead.
Mark?
I just wanted something I forgot to say a while back, so I'm going to throw it in here. But at the hospital, we are now going to be buying plates made out of potato. Is that right?
It's like
starch.
The corn
and,
starch.
And our cups and everything there, because of so much of our stuff has been going out with styrofoam.
You just eat it.
Huh? That's what I'm thinking.
It tastes the same, right?
And then one other thing that I have to throw in here, which is totally off the subject, but I was so happy that the hospital did this, and I meant to say it at our last meeting. We won an award for the local, we buy our produce and stuff from local farms, and the hospital is the number one buyer of local produce, because, you know, we feed people every day. And
right.
I just, this was my little spot to throw that in. I know it's way off.
It's okay.
But I just was
that's
very
to do
proud
with food
that the hospital won that. And I think, but this shows we're a local business, and a big one at that,
yeah.
that works very hard at making sure we are good citizens also. Okay, and I'm proud to work
are
at that place.
Are you up for promotion?
Huh?
PR director?
I should be.
You should? You should.
She ever leaves.
Well, I just wanted just to sort of piggyback on what Daryl was saying about the compostable containers, and that's what he's talking about, compostable containers and serving things. A lot of takeout businesses are using those compostable containers, but if you're putting them in the trash, they're just going into the trash. So you have to either figure out a way to save them and bring them, you know, and hopefully the Solid Waste Committee is working on trying to find at least a pilot project to be able to have another location for the Project COW, and which we'd really like to do. But if you have those things, try not to throw them in the trash. The paper trash can be saved forever in a day, and you can collect it. You can get together with your neighbors and load up somebody's car and take it down to the Solid Waste District and stick it in the Project COW.
There you go.
Mr. Schneck, I saw your hand up.
So I just took the survey sitting back here.
You did?
Yeah. I would first recommend that you put it up on Facebook because there are thousands of people, Brattleboro residents, on Facebook in the various groups. I will do it for you. I can do it for you. I might have missed it because I was taking the survey. Are you publishing the results of the survey?
We will.
Okay.
We will. Yes, definitely.
Thank you.
Great. All right, so you need to talk to me about how to get that on Facebook.
I'm going
to
do it right now.
Do you also say in the letter to do only one survey?
Yes. Thank you for pointing that out.
Okay.
Only one. So if you've already done it online, when it comes to you in the mail, you can recycle it. Keep your flyers, be educated, but don't answer the survey and send it back to us. All surveys that you do decide to send back to us via snail mail, that just going to go right to the town manager's office. And we'll compile those, add them to the Survey Monkey.
So, Cindy, just so we're clear, one per household then?
One per household. Okay. Yes, thank you. One per household. I think that's it. Can't think of anything else.
I was actually just talking to Barb about the motion for hiring you people about having some information for town meeting. And we'll figure something out. Either we'll have you come to the informational meeting, or you can have we'll figure it out, or have something.
We would like to have an opportunity to speak to the town meeting reps.
Yeah.
That'd be great.
We'll probably do that at an informational meeting. Mm-hmm. Okay?
Sure.
Sounds good.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you very much
okay.
for
yeah,
everything.
Yep.
Thank you.
We'll probably have you back here, I'm going to say sometime in June, because that way we'll have a report on how everything is going with the Sheriff's Department and Posse about the recycling.
Hope
to have you back here in June.
Good. And also I want to mention, then I remember, Moss and I are on the radio every Friday morning at 7 a.m., 92.7 with Fish. So we give you a little more tidbits about recycling.
Sure.
And people have been calling in, too. So you can always call in, ask those questions.
Yeah, thank you.
Tim does a noon interview every now and then.
Yeah, we were on BCTV with Tim.
I just put your survey on my Facebook page.
Yeah.
Okay.
No way, Tim, doing your part.
Thank you.
No.
Next is the purchase and sale agreement between the town of Brattleboro and Lee Byron Stuckey. There was a purchase and sale agreement signed, I believe, in 2010, May of 2010. We entered a purchase and sale agreement for property at 246 South Main. Stuckey's are now requesting to be released from the agreement and to have their deposit returned. They've attached a memo which they state, along with normal NIMBYism, too many reasonable neighbors raise reasonable objections to our plans and to the Dow's decision to sell. The board is then asked to approve what is called an agreement to terminate the purchase and sale contract. In that agreement, it states that I gave my agreement to somebody. The purchase and sale contract would be terminated. The town would return the deposit to Byron and Lee Stuckey. The town would not be required to return the application fees and costs. The town makes no representation as to its further use of the subject property, the 246 South Main, and retains all pertinent rights to it. And each party releases the other from any and all liability arising out of the purchase and sale contract for the property. And so that is what, those are the five items in the termination of the purchase and sale.
I would accept the motion.
Move to approve the agreement to terminate the purchase and sale contract between the town of Brattleboro and Lee and Byron Stuckey, and to authorize the town manager to sign the agreement.
Discussion. Jesse.
I am not going to vote in the affirmative for this motion. I think it's potentially setting a bad precedent. We have a contract with the buyer, the Stookies, and there's, you know, a meeting coming up with one of the town boards in the next week or two, and I don't see, you know, I think I just think we're setting a bad precedent in going ahead and proceeding with this method of terminating this contract when, you know, the contract could still be fulfilled.
Further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor of the motion on the floor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed?
No.
3-2, the motion passes.
Okay. Next we have another contract agreement, and that would be between the town of Brattleboro and Jonathan Chase, or Brooks House Realty LLC, Jonathan Chase Estate. The this would be for, as the board knows and many citizens know, the town rents a portion, about 20 spaces, parking spaces in the Harmony lot that are actually owned by Brooks House Realty. The that contract terminated December 31st, 2010. This extends the contract for 5 months, and I do notice it says 6 months in the motion, so that would be 5 months, from January 1st, 2011 to May 31st, 2011. We would continue to utilize the spaces in exchange for cleaning the area of snow. In addition, we would continue to utilize the tunnel, the arch high street access to Harmony Lot through the archway through this period of time. And this contract would terminate on May 31st. The board could discuss. I do not anticipate there would be any extension of the use of those parking spaces in the future, because there are other ideas and plans for that that the owner has for that property, and I think the town too has looked at how we can restripe that parking lot, and so we're at a point I don't believe that will go. I would anticipate that this contract would be the end of our renting of the space in that area as far as the parking lots. So with that, the board is asked to approve that purchase and sale, or I'm sorry, is asked to approve that lease agreement.
Mr. Chairman, I'd move to approve the five-month contract between the town of Brattleboro and Chase LLC for continued usage of the parking area in the Harmony lot. And I guess I should say that and authorize the town manager to sign the contract on behalf of the town.
Thank you.
Discussion.
I just want to say I'm not excited about this agreement, but I also recognize that the confusion and issues that can be raised by not giving a little time to prepare for this for the community. So I'm going to support it reluctantly.
Further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor of the motion on the floor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed?
Aye.
4-1. Thank you.
Next up, Larry Haynes, director of the Brattleboro Justice Center, is here to ask the board to accept and appropriate a $37,500 grant from the Vermont Agency of Human Services for his Circles of Support and Accountability. Larry.
Hi. Yeah, any questions you have? It's straightforward. You already approved the application a few months ago, so there's no new same amount, $37,500. This is all federal dollars. Okay, it's passed through to the state, and there's no fallout on the town.
I'll make a motion to accept and appropriate $37,500 from the Vermont Department of Corrections for the purpose of funding the Brattle Community Justice Center and developing circles of support and accountability.
Discussion. Jesse.
Yeah, two questions, comments. One, Larry, is this is nowhere in the anticipated or the budget that was drawn for this current year. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Okay.
there's an addition.
And the other, I see that the target population is a concern to me because they're the eligible offenders for conditional reentry will have served at least 1 year in jail and are considered to be at high risk to reoffend. And priority consideration will be given to high-risk sex offenders, then other sex offenders, and then high-risk felony offenders, and then all others. My question relating thereto is what training, what specific training do people have that, or will they be getting to deal with these types of individuals that will be released into our community?
Mm-hmm. Well, let me back up just a step. People that are going to be charged as, yes, they're people that have been there for a long period of time in prison, which would then basically beg the question if they're going to be felons. So they're coming out with generally violent offenses, domestic violence or sexual violence. Both of those offenses in this state have treatment programs at Southern State Correctional Facility in Springfield. It's the only place in the state you can get that. And anyone we would even consider minutely for 1 minute would be someone or would be persons who have gone through that training voluntarily. You don't have to take the training or the treatment in prison. If you don't, you can serve out your maximum sentence. If you do choose to do it, generally you get to go be considered after your minimum sentence has been achieved. And we would then start with a circle of support and accountability to go up to the prison and start making and engaging with that individual who would be coming out long before 3 to 6 months, sometimes as long as a year, before that person is returned to the community. So we develop that relationship, and it's somewhat based on the relationship and the rapport that's built with that individual, so that when the person comes back to the community, they know that there's 3 or 4 people in the community. If no one else is there for them, at least these 3 or 4 people, they have come to rely on somewhat and depend on for some assistance and support. The people who are on these COSAs, the Circles of Support and Accountability, are trained by us. We have 2 training nights, and then the state of Vermont, the Department of Corrections, has a mandated requirement to also do their training for any volunteers that work with incarcerated persons, and on top of that. So then with that, the persons are all given the prohibitions, the way to make boundaries that need to be done with working with these people. And then those types of things that need to be looked at that are concerns. I should say, further thing is that I sit on all the COSAs, all right, so that there is oversight locally in our office. And on top of that, we have a community advisory panel that meets on a quarterly basis and reviews all the people who have COSAs in this community. And those people include a victims advocate from the state's attorney's office, a retired probation and parole officer, and I'm looking at another person to join. We have 2 other people who sit and meet with these offenders on a quarterly basis so that they are satisfied that from where they sit as members in this community and their perspective and history and experience as a professional, that they're convinced and feel safe that behaviors are not causing any risk to our community. So there's at least 2 levels of oversight, Jesse.
And these individuals that would still be on probation or parole?
Yes.
So they would have a parole officer?
Absolutely.
Or a probation officer?
Bottom line is anybody coming out is going to be coming out on a furlough.
Right.
We don't deal with people who have maxed out. It'll be people coming out on furlough. And so that, yes, they have the remaining of their jail time is served in the community. Whether they have a split sentence or it's just probation until they serve out their term. As you probably know, for anyone accused of sex offending in our communities, those are not negotiable. For other people and offenses, usually the probation officer can go before the parole board and get a release earlier. That can't happen with sex offenses. They serve the total maximum time. And as you know, they continue to register for 20 years with the registry, so that we as citizens and the town and the police department know where these individuals are at any given point in time, or can find them. And if they're not there, then they, you know, are given a warrant for arrest.
Darrell?
Well, I just want to say that we are going to have a lot of folks getting out here, and with the restraints already on the state level, I'm glad that you guys are here, and I'm glad you got this grant so that we have something in place for when they get out so they don't just do the old circle U-turn and go right back in. Hopefully this will work. That's why I like these types of programs. And I think that the town of Brattleboro especially, being in the southern end of the state and we're the hub, unfortunately, and I think the chief will see it, this is where they're going to end up. So anytime we can get some programs in place, I'm supportive of that. Right. So thank you.
You're welcome. Should also note, that, as you probably already know, Board, that the people coming back to Brattleboro have come from Brattleboro.
That's right.
So we're not importing people from Newport and Rutland.
Any further questions? Discussions?
Thank you, Larry.
All right.
Yeah. All those in favor? Well, we need to.
You may still lose it.
You may still lose it. All those in favor of the motion on the floor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? 5-0.
Close one.
Thank you, Larry.
It's close.
Thank you, Select Board.
You bet.
Next,
it's warm for you,
Chief. Chief Wren is here to ask the board to accept and appropriate a $6,030 grant. Talk a little bit about what that is.
The Department of Public Safety governs highway safety program. They have an event scheduled throughout last year that we participated in, at least four of the events. It's for specific time frames. If we do so many motor vehicle stops within so many hours, we're eligible to apply for this grant, and we did that last year. And as a reward for participating in those events, we can obtain equipment up to $6,030.
$6,030 from the 2011 Department of Public Safety Governor's Highway Safety Equipment Incentive Grant for the purpose of purchasing safety equipment.
Discussion. Laura?
Well, just on the list of equipment, you have on here stationary and pole-mounted speed detection and recording system.
No, this is a list of things that are eligible to purchase.
Oh, okay.
We can go off that list and purchase things. What we're probably looking at is flashlights and breath testing devices.
Okay.
Further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? 5-0. Thank you. Thank you, Chief.
Earlier this evening, the board interviewed two candidates for a opening on the Planning Commission. That opening is actually from now until June 30th of this year. So the board is asked to make an appointment to the Planning Commission.
And we have the two people were Elizabeth McLaughlin and Timberly Hun, and just to remind everybody that we can nominate one, we can nominate both, and you can vote for one or you can vote for both, so you're not precluded. And then if there's a tie, we just keep doing that system until somebody gets tired of raising their hand. So I'll accept a motion.
I'll nominate Elizabeth McLaughlin.
Okay. Any other?
I'll nominate Timberly Hunt.
All right. All those in favor of Elizabeth McLaughlin signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. That's 4. All those in favor of Timberly Hunt signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. 2. And she gets 2 votes. And so it looks like Elizabeth is our Planning Commission member.
Thank you. And thank you both for applying.
And if I may, the only reason I did not vote for her is because she does as an alternate, but she is sitting on the DRB, which hopefully she'll get the experience and then she'll go on the DRB. Me personally, I like to get as many people in many places as we possibly can. That's why I didn't give her my vote. I think she's definitely well qualified.
That's a good point. Next, the board has done an advertisement for someone to sit on the Citizen Voice Communication Committee. We still do not have an application. An applicant.
How many serve on that committee?
How many people are on the CPCC?
was five.
Five, and there's, so there's one, and there's one opening, right? Four people.
Could one of us retirees at some point volunteer for that?
Sure could.
Are you volunteering now?
I would volunteer.
Can we do an interview?
Yeah.
I'd yeah. take it while there's a weak moment. But
excuse me. Interviews could be like 8:30 tonight.
Well, I'll nominate Martha O'Connor then to
serve on the CPCC.
CPCC.
How many openings we got?
Yeah, one.
Oh,
I thought there were two.
She's it.
No, one.
Oh.
And one of my concerns with the CPCC is that several years ago they had trouble getting a quorum.
Mm-hmm.
The board talked about terminating the committee. There was that spawned some interest from the community, but we are back to where we were previously, is having trouble making a quorum. So I would certainly accept Martha's nomination to sit on the committee, but if the committee is going to have a hard time making a quorum, the chief is there, the town manager goes to those meetings, and we're not going to have the interest, I would suggest revisit the issue of terminating that committee, which I supported before keeping the committee going, but it needs those volunteers to make those meetings. So we have a motion on the floor to appoint Martha O'Connor. All those in favor of that motion signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? 4-0.
Okay, and since we are doing this kind of stuff, and I don't know if I have to do this, but I would like to remain on the oversight, wastewater oversight committee. I don't know if that can be done. I don't know how many committee members you have.
I think Sarah should stay.
But I've been following this thing from since it started at the state level and on this level, and I'm very concerned about, I'm not really concerned, but I'd like to be part of, if I can. If not, that's something I don't have to be part of, that's fine. But I would like to, if I could, and you don't have to do that now, think about it, see how many members, but I would like to continue in that capacity if it's that
possible. Daryl did talk to me about that, and I think when we constituted the committee, we said five.
You may have to look, but you may also want to ask a couple of the other members who cannot make these meetings. That's why I am putting my name out there, because I do make most of them. And
is John Allen still on that committee?
Yes, and he's having a hard time. And Joe has a hard time. Joe makes them, but he has a hard time too. But I mean, I don't want to bump anybody off if they, but if they, you know, we need to have people at these meetings.
Yeah. Do everything we can to make sure that you stand that committee.
That's great. Okay. Well, you don't have to go too hard. I mean, come on.
Money helps. next is the that's how he yeah. How do you think Martha got it?
Yeah, I know. I
transportation committee. We have two people who applied. Peter Putnam and Becky Day, and I would request that they both be put on the transportation committee.
I would move that Peter Putnam and Rebecca Day be placed on the transportation committee.
Okay. That's great.
All those in favor, signify our discussion. They'll be welcome addition. All those in favor, the motion on the floor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? 5-0.
Good luck.
Okay, Jay. As you know, we have three board members leaving us. Actually, in my 5 years on the board, this is the first time that we've had three board members leaving without seeking, without at least one of them looking to get voted back into the board. I would just a couple of remarks. I would like to thank them. Daryl, I've never served with anyone with as much passion and belief about issues. I certainly haven't had to worry about where you stood on an issue, for sure. I appreciate your honesty and your candor and your willingness to change your mind and look at things. And I believe that you have been a true asset to the town of Brattleboro and all the people that you advocate for.
Wow. Let me shake your hand, sir. Very nice. Thank you.
Wow. Martha, to me, is the consummate politician. She understands politics. She understands the political game. I have learned much from her. She is as graceful in defeat as she is in victory. I have learned a lot of political maneuvering by watching Martha. She is also a strong advocate for the residents of Brattleboro, another person who is not afraid to speak their mind, and it is appreciated. You certainly know where Martha is coming from, and I thank her for her 3 years of service. She certainly came to the board in a time when the town was in some influx, and I have appreciated her insight, and I will miss her greatly. Thank you, Martha. Last but not least for me is Jesse Corn. He, to me, is the consummate board member. Without a doubt, he has elevated the game on the select board. He has made me a better select board member. I have never served with anyone who has come to board meetings more prepared and understands the issues at hand. He doesn't take things personally. He looks at things from a multitude of perspectives, and I would certainly call him a conservative, and although a conservative, he has certainly understands the issues that Brattleboro as a community faces and doesn't just vote on the conservative line. And I think that's great when you have board people of political ilk that are willing to look at both sides and vote what's best for the town and not follow what I would call a political affiliation. And I thank you for all you have done for this community. You certainly led us through the wastewater treatment project, and I thank you for that, and I hope you allow me to call you at any time that I need some consoling and advice, and thank you for your 3 years on the board. And so I will allow the three board members to have the last word, and unless Dora has something that she might want to add.
Well, actually, very eloquently spoke. I don't really have much to add, except that I just, we have here three people who are leaving this board who have given a number of years of service to this community in different ways. The town is going to be losing a collective wisdom that I hope that they're going to continue to share with us, even though they're leaving. That will be missed, and we'll be getting three new board members, and we'll have some different perspectives and new things being brought to the board. But definitely, I've learned a lot from all three of you, like I said, I hope you're going to continue. I'm glad Martha's put her name in for a committee, and Daryl wants to, and maybe Jesse will too. we need to continue and keep those ties.
Well, I'll start with Martha.
Dick, I didn't prepare a 10-page speech like Jesse did here.
But see his.
I could see what he's got to say here. I thank you as chair. You have been a tremendous chair. And Jesse was chair the year before. And the quality that the two of you brought to this board can never be matched. It's been wonderful. I also have very strong feelings for the quality of work that Barb Sontag does. I think she's underpaid and underappreciated on a daily basis of what she knows. The department heads in this community are fabulous, just absolutely wonderful, as along with the entire staff. We have a staff in this town that I think you could match with anyone. They care, they're hardworking, they're diligent, they're always on duty. And they all have a sense of humor, but just very hardworking. The press that has been here, very fair to all of us. Sure, there's a screw-up once in a while, and we let you know about it. But you have always been with us. You've been very supportive, and you've been very fair and ask us questions, which you should, and hold our feet to the fire. But thank all of you for what you do. And I certainly hope that the new class of select board members come in with an open mind. Don't come in with just one project that you want to get through. You have to look at everything that goes on in this town and keep an open mind. Doesn't hurt to listen for a while and to listen to your town manager. And but thank you. I've had 6 years on this board, and I've appreciated all of it. And now it's time to retire and do some fun stuff. So thank you.
Daryl?
Well, I said my goodbyes last time, so thank you, everybody. I also would say kudos to our department heads. They do a great job, as well as the workers that are out there. I am very proud of the town employees that we have, and it starts at the top, which is Barb Sontag. I think she is a huge asset to this community, and she's gained a lot of my respect. And I also got to say, I got to thank Jan, because Jan's taken care of me for the last year, so thank you very much, Jan. I always have something to have, my water, she just takes good care of me, and if I needed a secretary, I'd hire you away, I tell you that. And one other thing about our department, the folks, is if you walk into the planning department, this is where they go above and beyond, because I forgot to thank them the last time, too. They painted it, and it looks wonderful. And our people do a lot more than just what they're supposed to do, because they understand the town restraints also. So it's been a blast. I've enjoyed my time doing this stuff. Thank you, Brattleboro, for believing me. And who knows, maybe I'll be back someday, maybe not. Right now, it's me and Bridget. But thank you. Now, let's let them go. I got to go to the bathroom.
Well, I would echo for sure the comments that both my fellow select board members, Daryl and Martha, have made with respect to the town employees from the bottom to the top. There's no question about that we have excellent department heads, great employees, and a super town manager. There's no question about that. But I want to say just a few things, describe, if I could, and the adjectives I'm using to describe the select board are my words. Maybe someone will agree with me, some may not. But I think in talking about the select board, it's serious. I think about the $32.8 million bond vote and all the preparation for that when I think of the seriousness of the board. It's exciting, like working with Commonwealth Dairy and the possibility of having a real positive local impact on this economy. It's lengthy. How about the day-long budget meetings with all the department heads and town managers that we had? It's excruciating. I think about cogitating on the plans for the Chestnut Hill Dam. It's challenging. Figuring the pro forma for the water and sewer rates for the next few years and working through that with Hoyle Tanner, Barb, and John Leisering. It's tinkering. Reworking the town's tax stabilization plan or the purchase policies for the town from local merchants. It's boring, let's face it. Voting numerous times on parking space on east side of Main Street in front of the River Garden is not the most challenging work. It's off the wall. Well, what about discussing mast arms for the nth time when they were on the wall here for over a year? It's awe-inspiring. Making committee appointments and then hearing from them, particularly the Town Arts Committee. Relaxing. Well, come on now. We don't get paid the big bucks for R&R, but we do get exposed to Barb Sontag's wonderful sense of humor on a regular basis, which is worth the price of admission. And lastly, but not leastly, it's dull. I dislike ending with the D, but this after all, approval of the annual dog warrants and the town's road mileage are not high up on the chart of engaging. I've no doubt taken up my 2 minutes. It has been a real privilege, though, to serve on this board as a vice chair, as the chair, and in this my last year as clerk, which I very gracefully took over, I thought, from Martha O'Connor, who did a wonderful job.
You took it away from me. I loved it.
We've had our disagreements, but I think we have handled those in a civil, polite, and professional manner, all with a view of being in the town's best interests. To all of my fellow board members, it has been a pleasure, and I wish only the best for this town. And to Dora and Dick, all the best in the next year. Hopefully you won't miss Daryl, Martha, and me too much. God bless, and good luck.
Thank you. Thank you. Meetings.
Standard.
Boring.
That's what this is.
I thought we got watches. No watches.
Senate Police Communication Committee, February 17th, 5 p.m. Nahana. Select Board Committee, Skateboard Park Committee, 2/17, 6 p.m. The Senior Center at the Gibson Aikens Traffic Safety, February 22nd, 8:30 in the Select Board Room. That's 8:30 a.m. A special select board meeting is February 22nd, 4 p.m. in the select board meeting room. Conservation Commission, February 22nd, 5:15 in the Hannah Cosman. DRB, February 23rd, 7 p.m. in the select board meeting room. Planning Commission, February 28th, 6 p.m. select board meeting room. West River Park, February 28th, 6:30 p.m. Gibson Aikens. Conference Center, and then March 1st is I find out who my new bosses are.
Yeah, and don't forget to vote, please.
Please vote. Yes. And I think there's a candidates forum.
March 1st.
Thursday night, candidates forum. What time, Tim?
7.
Where at?
Here.
Right here. Beautiful. There you go.
It's going to be live, right?
Ken ought to know.
Live?
There you go. Well, get out and vote. Again, not only for the candidates, we have two, we'll be having two article questions that are important to the town. And I will accept a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Last official meeting. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? 5-0. Thank you, and thank you, BCTV.
Don't forget to shut the lights off.
Yes, BCTV, thank you.
Well, thank you.